Okay. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. And before I start in on Genesis, I want to remind you of something I said at the end of the class last time, and that is, should the Lord share something with you in relationship to the things we're discussing that can go into the areas of quantum physics or astrophysics or any other kind of physics or whatever, write it down, jot it down, and I'd like to give people an opportunity to share. And the reason why I'd like to do that is because at the end of last class, several people shared some things with me that they that they were meditating on, and they were really good things, really, really good stuff. So, do that, and it's we're not talking about for a grade. It's not required. You don't have to do this, but there is the possibility that we'll get an opportunity to have you share some things with everyone else that you've seen. All right. Genesis chapter 2, and we're going to start with we're just going to read verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. All right. So we have at least two different elements in the creation of man. We have his body, and his body was formed from the dust of the ground or the dust of the earth. But there was something else added. God breathed into him the breath of life. And then the Bible says he became a living soul. So we see here several different elements. One is a creative act, and the other one is not a creative act at all. It is an impartation. Okay. The creative act was in relationship to man and his body. But man became a partaker of the breath of life, according to the scriptures here. And so, and we'll get into this more as we go, possibly tonight, maybe not. We realize that science can only take you so far. Science can only take you so far. But there are some things that you can discover in relationship to this. For example, it says the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground or the dust of the earth. Okay. Now, if God created the earth by means of a Big Bang theory, is that possible? Sure. If God did it that way, and then God took particles, all the basic building blocks of creation, and from those particles, from that dust, from that dirt, from those original creation particles form man's body, then it would make sense that if you examined your cells, you examined your molecules, you examined your atoms, that they would be basically the same substance as everything else. Does that make sense? Yeah. Because it came from those elements. All right? I was hoping a few more people here, someone in specifically, was going to be here tonight because I want to just give a little explanation of some of these things so that we can really understand subatomic particles and what have you. But using the chalkboard, I wrote these things on the board just before class. Body, organs, cells, molecules, atoms, electrons and protons, quarks and gluons, and strings. This is by no means exhaustive, but this is sort of a trail of where you come with quantum physics. And that is, if you start with man and you give him a body, oops, he's got a pointed leg there. He has a body, and as we just read in Genesis, even though God made that body, you can't really say that God created it. You can't even say God created light, not that he didn't, but I mean that in the account of Genesis, he says, let there be light. Maybe there was already light and he released it because there was darkness upon the face of the earth, on and on and on and on. just trying to throw some stuff out here, and really that is the purpose of the whole thing. So, he didn't create man's body. He formed it, and really that's literally what it says in verse 7. And the Lord God formed man, speaking of his body, he formed that from particles. Okay, dust, and the particles that make up dust. All right, so just to work our way down, you start with the body, but within that body are different organs, you know, brain and all this kind of stuff. And so, and this is sort of important because you're not going to really understand the Lord unless you understand that there are different foundations. And I'll explain that more as we go. The body is one foundation, meaning it is a study of a structural reality for science. But organs, a liver or whatever, intestine or brain or heart or all of that, make up that body, doesn't it? And without those organs, the body really wouldn't function, and yet those organs are the body, aren't they? They're just the internal organs, just like the nose and the ears and all that are external. All of it is the body. But this body really is tied together with this skin. Outwardly and inwardly, it is tied together with the same life. Every ounce of it has the same life. Every ounce of it ultimately functions by life, not by its function. Like the heart does a function, it pumps blood. The liver does its function, it purifies. All of these things, and yet that's their function. But only life causes them to function. So they are all partakers of one life, all of the organs and all of the parts. And from this we discover that everything is not just simple, and yet it is simple. Everything will continue to be broken down toward more simple elements, and yet the main element of all of it is life. And more importantly, the same life. And more spiritually, for the body of Christ, it is the life of Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are not just Christians. And we are not just believers. We are the body, the vehicle, the container of Christ's life. And when you say body, folks, you are talking about Jesus in a specific way. You're not talking about him as Savior. You're not talking about him as healer per se. I mean, he can heal the body, but that's not really. When you talk about Christ's body, you're not talking about him healing his body You're talking about him being the life in that body. All right. So then, if you, and that's, you know, at first you just look, you know, and when man first was created and for centuries after that, man looked and he said, look, that's a person. That's who they are. That's how they are. But then as you draw closer, you begin to discover organs. But then as you examine those organs, and even though they are all different organs with different functions, they're all made up of what? Cells. Everything is made up of cells. Okay? And in that reality, you begin to find certain things. And a cell, obviously, you know, you can't hardly see it, so I'll just make little dots to represent 80 billion cells that your body is made up of. And then if you go deeper, then you realize that those cells are made up of molecules. In other words, you have a single cell, but that single cell is made up of molecules. And even 100 years ago, they didn't even know this. You know? And then you keep examining and you go deeper, and after molecules, you realize that every one of those cells is made up of atoms. Or every one of those cells is made up of molecules, and every molecule is made up of atoms. Okay, now if you just consider that for a minute, you are finding deeper and deeper systems. I'm going to put it like that, systems. Because, for example, an atom is not just a single entity in itself. Neither were molecules, neither were cells, neither were organs. That an atom is made up of electrons and protons and neutrons, and I didn't put them all down there. And even a system within an atom is the nuclei. So what do we, you know, other than studying science here, which we're not, we have to be confronted with the God who made all this, and we're not even finished going down the list, and in fact, I don't know that science can go down the full list, but nonetheless, that's why much of it's called quantum theory. Okay. But there are system upon system that God made, smaller, and in one sense, you could even say more powerful. I mean, you take the atom and you split the atom, and what happens? Nuclear bomb goes off. You know, that's how you make an atom bomb. Atom, where are we? Atom bomb. By splitting the atom, it causes nuclear fission, which causes it to just start smashing into one another, and all of the atoms cause a horrible, horrible destruction, okay? Because they're all banging into each other. Now, isn't it interesting, though, that the system of the atom will do that, but the system of, say, the cells won't. You take two cells and start banging them together or split it, and they don't explode. Now, isn't that interesting? Because God has set up all of these systems and everything. All right, so when we talk about quantum mechanics and quantum physics, we're talking about the study of subatomic particles. Okay, so that's not the body, that's not organs, that's not cells, that's not molecules, that's atoms, but that's sub, that's below atoms. That's all of the particles that are below atoms. And, you know, I mean, it hadn't been all that many years ago that everybody said, well, you're made up of atoms. And atoms are made up of how many parts as far as how they function? Not the next layer down, but how they function. Three. Okay? And within that system, within that three that's one, those three make up an atom. You discover certain realities of how God sets stuff up. Okay? But let me just make sure you understand this. When we talk about quantum theory and quantum mechanics and this sort of stuff, quantum physics, it is primarily dealing with everything below atoms, sub-atoms, atomic. Sub-below, atomic is atoms. And so you're, in this case, we're talking about electrons and neutrons and protons, but below that are quarks and gluons are just something that actually starts holding some things together. But quarks are an interesting little study in themselves, and I don't know how soon or how fast we get into that, but they've discovered 12 quarks. Okay, now, there were 12 tribes, there were 12 apostles, and all this kind of stuff. Yes, comment? Right. Yeah. Well, let me finish this statement, and that is, I did a study a long time ago on foundations, and I was blown away because the scriptures talk about being built not just on a foundation. There's a scripture that talks about being built on that foundation, which is Jesus Christ. But then it talks about that the 12 apostles are the foundation of the New Jerusalem. And then it talks about other foundations, and I'll let you do the study. But it's amazing to me. And if you, you know, and speaking spiritually now, but using physics, if you start studying down these things, body and organs and cells and molecules and atoms, and you come to quarks, you might say, like they did with cells, and then they found molecules, and then they were, oh yeah, this is it. Oh yeah, and then they found atoms, and they were, this is it. And then that, you see what I mean? And it kept going down and down. So you finally get down here to quarks, and you say there are 12. And the foundation of everything is quarks, and there's 12 of them. Okay. That's just like, what would you call it, an apostolic church that has founded everything on the 12 apostles, okay? And is it true? It is true that it's a foundation, but it is not the foundation. And we're looking for the foundation. And again, we're not talking about physics. So what I'm telling you is, it is possible to discover in the Word or from the Lord a new level and a new foundation and stop and camp on that one truth and not continue till you found the foundation. And so men will make this and that and this and that the foundation. Okay? And in a truth, they are foundations. There are certain things that are not, but there are certain things that are. But they are, again, not the foundation. And so, but they have stopped and they've assumed that it is the foundation. All right. So then, you know, you get down and where we're at now in quantum physics is that the final thing that they believe is, there's actually two different views, string theory or loop gravity. And they believe that the final is one or the other of those. Okay. Well, that's fine. But whatever the final is, it is going to be the clearest picture of something. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not going to be some random, just, you know. What we're talking about here is finding the beginning point, the building block, chief cornerstone, the building block of all matter. Or, spiritually speaking, the building block upon which everything else is built and finds its unity, finds its reality. All right, so you get into body, you get into anatomy and physiology and stuff like that, into organs, you get into biology and biochemistry and that sort of stuff, molecules, molecular science, atoms, atomic physicists, I guess is what you'd call them, and on down. Everything down here, quantum physics. What this is telling you, these are not random thoughts. What this is telling you is there are a lot of different fields of study and a lot of different specialists. Now, we're still speaking spiritually here. There are a lot of specialists that pick one and they get good with that one. And they get so good that they can quote unquote disprove everybody else and they can prove that their thing is the thing. And are you following me here? Just like in Christianity, people latch hold on some area, something, and they hold on to it and they make it everything. But in reality, there are many, many other fields apart from just these that we've mentioned. We have mentioned astrophysics and sociology and biochemistry and music. We've even mentioned that. Botanists, marine biologists, on and on and on. There's all of these different fields. And when I saw something there, I wrote this down. I said, like the Tower of Babel, all these have their own language. And let me tell you, they do. There's a terminology to quantum physics. There's a terminology to astrophysics. There's a terminology to music. I don't even read music. And somebody once tried to sit down, somebody who graduated from UNT and had a degree in music and everything, who played the guitar. And I said, well, could you explain to me, you know, what's all this mode stuff, the mixolydian, and what is all the Rigian? There's all these modes. All of those are terminologies. All of those is the language of that field. And if you're not in, you're not going to get the language. You're not going to understand the language. And I said, can you explain? So he started explaining, and he talked, and he talked, and talked. And I said, no, wait a minute. Let me see if I get this right. If you had a bunch of different musicians that play guitar sit in a circle, okay, and they're all in a circle, and they all have a guitar, and the guitar is all tuned exactly correct and the same. And I said, if someone played a C chord, you say, okay, everybody play a C chord. They go ring, and basically it would sound the same. If you played it higher up on the octave or whatever, but it would basically be the same chord with exactly the same notes, right? And he said, yes. And I said, so these modes, you know, mixolydian and da-da-da-da, I said, there's only so many notes in one chord. I mean, it's not like there, I mean, you only got six strings there, so it's only, you know, you can't go to 80 million notes. I said, so you really could only have within each mode six or maybe seven or eight at the most notes for each of the modes, right? And he said, right. And I said, and since there's so many modes, like five or six or something like that, how many? Eight modes. You know, since there's that many modes, and you've only got six strings, then this mode must leave out this note and introduce this one over here. And this one over here leaves that one he introduces out, plays this one, but but you're only, the whole thing is only reaching one or two notes beyond six. And he said, yeah. And I said, so, if the guitar players that are sitting there, if one is a Mexican, and one is an Arab, and one is Chinese, and one is rock and roll, and one is folk music, and one is, and they're all dressed like their little area, and you said, you play. Okay, he'd play his deal, and he said, play it. I said, they would all basically be, the vast majority of what they play would be the same notes, only one or two differences with each of them. And those one or two differences is all that makes it Spanish as opposed to this or that, because it, blues is a great example of that. Great example. You just add a few notes, they call them blue notes. That's it, just a few, okay? All right. And I said, so really, it's, all of this modes and all this stuff is just a real difficult way of explaining. Am I right or am I totally off on this? And he's sitting there thinking the whole time, and he goes, you're right, man. He turns to me and said, I spent 4 years in college to learn what you told me in about 10 minutes. Yeah. That. Why I'm bringing that up is this. At the Tower of Babel, all of these people divided up and they went with their own language and they got their own terminology, and it all basically is trying to say the same thing. It's just saying it in a different way. Hi, how you doing? What, you know what I mean? I mean, it's not like there's this language over here is saying whole different things than everybody. They all say hi and how you doing? Did that hurt? Is it, raining? They're all saying the same thing. And it's just their way of doing it, their way of building this language to make it sound all complicated and all this kind of stuff, when in reality, every one of them is seeking to break down their field, because we talked about astrophysics or all these ones, sociology. They're seeking to break it down to understand it, and then they're seeking to put it back together so that it makes sense to them, right? Okay, sociology. A sociologist would do that. Anthropologists. All of these different ones are just trying to study, but what they are studying is, get ready, parts. And if you become a professional at some part, you still don't have, number one, the whole or the foundation, the core, the central truth that holds them all together. Okay? You follow me? Now, this point right there is the key to the whole universe. Oh, sorry, y'all missed that. Anyway, and we didn't get it recorded, but it's not that important. Just kidding about it being the key. I'm just messing with that. All right, so among them, many people are seeking to find the answer to all life. What is the central core? What is the central truth? What is the unifying feature that ties everything together? Am I right that they are? Okay, well, let's discuss who. What fields are seeking to find the key to all life? Give me one.
Psychology.
Pardon?
Psychology.
Okay. astrophysics. I mean, every time they send a thing out there, they tell you with the hope of discovering where life came from and where it all began, right? Okay, quantum physics. They are trying to break this whole thing down to the thing that is the foundation stone of it all. Okay? Pardon?
Mathematics.
I don't know how much they can, but they are, because that's physics. That's physics. Geneticists. They're studying DNA to find the root cause, the root core of everything. Anthropologists. They're studying ancient remains, trying to find the answers to life and to this stuff. Spiritualists, people that are into that, they're studying supernatural. Every one of them are trying to find a key. Can I say the key? And that's what's driving them. They're trying to find the answer. And here's the killer, when we use the example that all of these things make up this one body. They believe that their area is the important area, and that their language is the correct one. From the Tower of Babel, that their language, their terminology, their truth, their thing is the real one, is the true one. All right, why do they believe that? How can it be so diverse? Even in the body of Christ, how can things be so diverse? I remember hearing a guy say, well, if there's only one God, why are there so many denominations? But folks, it's worse than that. I mean, it's way worse than that. I mean, there are people that are not part of a denomination that have their leaning that this is the truth or that is the truth. And you don't even have to get into spiritual subjects with that. Ministering to children. Ministering to children is what it's all about. You can't, you know, it's harder to unlearn adults than it is to teach children. So we all go, well, that makes perfect sense. My God, we ought to be doing more children's ministry. We ought to shut everything else down and do children's ministry. Okay? Well, someone says, well, there wouldn't be nothing if we didn't pray. We got to pray. Prayer is everything. You don't pray, forget it. Well, you know, Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, folks. That's our task. We got to go into all the world and preach the gospel. You just keep going and go. Everybody grabs hold of something. Even if it's deeper or whatever in the reality of the makeup of the body of Christ, they've grabbed hold of atoms or molecules or cells or organs or electrons or protons or quarks or whatever the area is. They have grabbed hold of that and they've specialized. And in most cases, the search for the true core thing, the central truth of all truths, they've given up on the search because they've found what they've found. And they want everyone else to know that they're the ones who found, you know, something important. So, well, let me read a little bit here because our class is getting pretty much done here. What is our frame of reference? To truly get to the core issues of Christianity will require that every believer hands in his old way of viewing things and takes on a new frame of reference. Okay. The goal is not to explain that. You know, like in terms of, well, here's what you hand in and here's what you're looking for. That's not the goal. We may do that along the way, but just telling them what to hand in and what they're looking for really does not spell it out. Because what they're looking for, just like what you were looking for people could tell you all about it. They could describe it. You know, let's just consider, since we can all go back to when we got saved. You know, in my situation, when I was in my teenage years, we were wild, man. But in the neighborhood, there were three or four different coffee houses, because this was the 60s, and part of the 60s was folk music and coffee houses. And so a bunch of people, all the kids would come down to the coffee house, and we'd hang out and drink coffee and talk, and that nice atmosphere, and people get up and play music and do all this kind of stuff. And it was great. Well, my group, we'd go in there and play all the time, and they loved to have us play because we were good. You know, that would either be me and Mike Gentry and my brother doing that kind of music, or it would be me and this other friend of mine, Larry Sanford, doing more of a Simon and Garfunkel type stuff. But they loved to have us. But their purpose was to get you in there and, get Jesus in you. And they would talk about Jesus. And, I remember this guy standing there with this suit. He was like 16, 15-year-old, kid, trying to tell me about Jesus. My hair's long. I'm dressed in knee-high moccasins and, see-through shirts with puffy sleeves and, it was the 60s, And, and I'm going, look, if I accept your Jesus, am I going to turn out like you? And he said, yeah. And I said, forget it. That didn't look good to me. And one time I came out and my friend Larry had dropped acid, and so he wasn't doing so good. And another guy had a big old Bible and had him cornered and was doing this. And I came up and peeled that guy off of him. I said, if I ever see you messing with my guys again, I'm going to break your lips, Anyway. I didn't have a good picture of religion or of Jesus, because that's what I thought Jesus was. That's what I thought Jesus was. And people tried to tell me, But one day when I met Jesus, he was nothing like what I thought he was going to be like. He was so cool, so real, so alive, so different, so, answering to things that were not based on my head, answering things in my heart, So the truth is, our attempts to describe the unveiling of Christ really aren't going to work. You do know that, don't you? You can't. You can share things that will stir people's heart, because that happened to me. I got jealous that someone knew the Lord so much more than I did, and I went, I want to know the Lord like that. Literal jealousy. I was going, I want to know, where does he get all this stuff? And I said, God, you said you're no respecter of persons. He said, well, I don't, but you don't get in the word. I went, oh, okay. I'm open, Lord. I'm moving toward you. So I'll read it again. To truly get to the core issues of Christianity will require that every believer hands in his old way of viewing things and takes on a new frame of reference. To shake us up enough to do this, I want to present some concepts that might challenge our conventional way of seeing things. Our concepts, because they seem stable on earth, become how we evaluate and view everything. And what I mean by that is simply this. Folks, all of our views come from earth. Now, that may seem simplistic, but in light of space and everything, it's not simplistic at all. It is an incredible reality that all of our views come from the earth. Even if you go to the moon, which is as far as we've been, folks, that's still in the gravitational pull of the earth, and therefore the laws of earth life, and I'll explain this as we go, are in effect. Therefore, the scriptures tell us in Colossians 3, seek those things which are above. Okay, well, we know that doesn't mean seek truths of the universe and quasar and all that. But we are using astrophysics to help us to see that there is a whole different realm out there. Because we evaluate based on the earth, things become accepted facts. For example, time and distance, or space-time. And in physics, they don't call it time and space anymore. If you know anything about physics nowadays, it's called space-time. It is linked. It's called space-time. Okay? And that's how they refer to it. It's actually one word. For example, if this is a simple one, then we'll go to some other concepts. But if you were on a train and you're standing in that boxcar and you're in there and the train is going this way and you're facing the direction of the train, then you say, okay, now the front of the train is this way, front is this way, and backwards is this way. So you say, okay, so I can remember this. I'm going to go over and I'm going to write on this back wall back, and I'm going to write on the front wall front, okay? So you get this destination, and this train, and I'm sure you've seen it, they have a locomotive in front, but they pull one from behind too. You ever seen that? So you get to this particular station, and all of a sudden the one from behind kicks in. You finished your journey. It only went this far. Now it's going back. And all of a sudden, you're standing there, and it's heading that way, and you're going, you automatically turn around, and you go, this is front, while you're staring at your words written there that says back. And you look over there, and you go, that says front. And everything that you believed has just changed because of the way things are in earth and the way that we comprehend things, okay? All right, let's see, make sure I... And that deals with direction. Space, let's talk about that. Space is mostly understood in relationship to time. When I say space, I don't mean universe space. I mean distance from here to Chicago. The space that's in between, we have to take in time in consideration to that. You can't just take in space. Distance in terms of amount of space also determines how much time visiting someone will take. If somebody lives far away and you want to visit them, you don't just think of the distance, you think of the time, don't you? Time is tied to that situation. Distance or space only has meaning in relationship to how long it takes to get somewhere. Space, time are linked together. But consider this. What if in your house, in your living room, you had different doors, a door here, a door there, a door there, a door there. Let's say you had five doors, and the new space company that has set those doors up allows you to have five friends. This sounds familiar. Something about a telephone plan or something. It gives you five friends. And as you go to each door, when you step through that door, you are immediately teleported to that city, that moon, that planet, whatever. And all of a sudden, distance means nothing. And therefore, time really is not that big of a factor other than how much you spend there. Distance is no longer an issue, okay? And therefore, time is no longer an issue. Let me give you another example. Up, down, east, west. People right now are standing on the earth in different locations, right? But the earth is a globe, it's a ball. To someone at the South Pole, the direction below their feet is down. Do I need that's down. Am I right? Or someone's over here and they're saying, no, this is down. Right? But really, who's right? Well, we would say somebody on the North Pole. But that's a whole nother story because that's still wrapped up in Earth. Okay? We're not ready to deal with that right now. So your understanding of direction seems so stable and so clear, but it's only stable and clear to you where you're at under your circumstances. And theirs is completely different in a completely different direction, still called up, down, right, left. You see what I'm saying? We haven't even left the earth yet on these realms that we're talking about here. So we're just presenting a few things. All right, another example is time. Time is thought of as to where we are. Most of the time when we think of time, we think of where we are. Have you ever called someone on the East Coast or in another country and woke them up? I remember one of the first times we called somebody in Ireland, and it was in the middle of the night. And I went, it ain't the middle of the night, it's noon or whatever, whatever time it was, No, this is what time it is. No, that's what time it is to you where you are in your situation and in your location. But that's relative. That's not stable. Up and down is relative. Altitude, I guess I probably got that in there too, is relative. Because altitude is up. We'd say that's up, but that's going down. Are you at least getting my point? That even in the natural folks, a whole lot of stuff that we think is stable and clear and we got it all figured out is not stable and clear at all. And it's not all figured out at all. It is only stable and clear to us because that's where we're at in this thing. And as long as we're comfortable, then we feel like everything's good. All right. So our concept of time and now is not a stable concept. It is based on a clock which man made. Okay, have you ever considered that? Yeah. It's based on a clock. We made that clock, by the way. It marks time based on Earth's rotation. But what if you're away from the Earth? What if you're anywhere else in the galaxy? Do you see what I'm saying? Now how do you mark time? In fact, I wrote, it marks time based on Earth's rotation, but away from Earth, how do we mark true time? On our planet, that's how we mark time, but is that true time or is that Earth time? Is that Earth life? Okay? Then if time is the way we say it, then we can do time travel. Get ready and you say, I want to celebrate New Year's Eve in Japan. So you fly to Japan and finally New Year's Eve comes and that night I go, 10, 9, 8, and you've got some friend there with a video camera or a camera, and it's like, 2, 1, Happy New Year, Kong Takala, and they take a picture of you and there's all, and da da da, and you say, my God, this was so fun. I think I want to celebrate New Year's in Australia. So you fly to Australia and you wait and then finally 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Happy New Year! Throw a shrimp on the Barbie and they take a picture of that, And you keep moving, you keep moving. In that direction, you go to London, you do it there, then you go to New York, and you do it there, then you go to Texas, and you do it there, and then you go to Los Angeles, and you do it there, and then you go to Hawaii, or I forget where it starts, but I think it's Japan. Yeah, the sun rises on. Okay, so you got all these pictures. and they're all at the exact same time, and you show your family and friends, look, I did time travel. I traveled in time. This is all exactly at the same time. And I was in all of these places at once. And they go, uh-uh. And you say, look at the big ball, the numbers on the back. I'm telling you, I was with those people at New Year's Eve 2010. This one too, this place. And they're going, how can this be? How can this be? But none of it could happen if it was now, true now. But our minds have been molded in a certain way of thinking, and it's all based on the earth. It is all based on the earth. And let's see. So I don't know if I want to jump to our next one or not. Maybe I'll save the last one for our next class. So, my point of all this is to shake up our way of thinking, because we think, even in, you know, I'm talking about the Lord, but I'm using physical examples to say, well, do I actually have 10 minutes more? Okay, if necessary, I'll read this last one then, because it'd be nice to change. But if we realize these things, all of a sudden we're realizing that all the things that we think are true measurements are not true measurements at all. They are measurements for us now in our life, in our place. Okay, let's go this one, our view. We can be at the right place, meaning the right space or location, but have a mixed up view. And I thought about this. I have this deck in the front of our house upstairs, and sometimes I sit out there and I meditate more than I do anything. And if you look across the street, there's some houses over there, angled over there, and there's street and cars and everything. And if you just, you know, if you look at things, and you don't have to be outside, you can be in the living room or looking at furniture or whatever, and you look and you say, everything is level. Everything is straight. The world is straight and level. But if you do one little thing, if you just tilt your head like this, all of a sudden things look, this looks level, and everything's starting to tilt. Oh my God, what is happening here? What's happening with the world? You know? Oh no, the roof is, I never even noticed the roof that much, but now it's coming in on me. Very simple explanation, but it's all your point of view. And you turn that point of view, and everything that seemed this is straight or this is straight, all of a sudden that feels more straight than that. I remember at Six Flags, they used to have a thing that you went through, and it was called, what was it called? Do you remember? That's it, Casa Magnetica. And it was all based on building the house not straight, but like this, so that when you walked in, it felt so weird because you're walking like this and you feel like, you know, and then they set a ball down, and the ball starts rolling down this thing and going, and you're going, gravity is growing crazy. You know, this is weird. And it's all based on pulling just everything slightly one direction and making you think that that's level, that's straight. Okay? So I wrote, if you look out your front door at the street and house, all looks level and straight, but if you lean your head slightly to one side, your world looks slanted. Here's the question. Is this distortion due to a slanted world or a slanted view? Which one? What? Slanted world or slanted view?
Slanted view.
Okay, maybe both. That's what I wrote. This is my meditations. Your head is turned, but also you are near the equator and your feet are either up or down. You're right here, so that's not necessarily level. This is, you know what I'm saying? Do you see what I'm saying? If you're actually, we're closer to the equator, we're here. Then in reality, it's not level. Gravity is the only thing holding us sideways. Am I right or wrong? Or is there just this flat earth and we're all on the flat earth? See? And that's what they used to believe, the earth was flat. All right. Our earth, our frame of reference in terms of space and time, proximity, north, south, east, west, top, bottom, is based on ourselves being the center of those equations. When we're the center of the equation, then this is what we come up with. For us, no matter where we're located on the planet, we think of altitude as up. And again, altitude is up to them, but it's not up. It is up for us, but is it up for the universe? And then I ask, in space, is there actually an up? I mean, I'm trying to shake all of the earth thinking to say we need to step outside of the earth and see how God views stuff. And the reason why I wrote that is I said, is in space, is there really an up? For example, if you float in space alone, no, you don't see any planets or anything, you're just floating in space. You do not know what is up or down, east or west, top or bottom. You see what I'm saying? You could be, but you have nothing, no frame of reference. You're just floating in space. Well, you don't know. And there's no gravity to pull your blood down if you were upside down. That's earth life. You see what I'm saying? Because if you're upside down, then the blood rushes to your head. But that's on earth. That's not out there. There is no gravity out there pulling you anywhere. So how do you know? And if you took a gun and fired it, trust me, since there is no friction, you can't tell if the bullet's leaving you or you're leaving it, or both. You can't tell. There's no wind, there's no friction. So you can't tell if it's moving or you're, you don't know. You could be upside down and moving 100 miles an hour and you wouldn't know it. Really? Because you have none of the things that we have on earth that earth life tells us this is the way it is. And heavenly life has a completely different order. All right, let me make sure I get this before we... for example, if you float in space alone, you do not know what's up or down, east or west, top or bottom. East or west, come on. In space, east, well, the east is that. That's based on the sun rising and setting. That is an effect of space with no gravity. In both cases, you need a frame of reference. You need a frame of reference. If you had an object there and all of a sudden you're going backwards, you could tell that you were going backwards. Am I right or wrong? You could tell. And if you knew that object was quote unquote magnetic north, which we don't know that other planets are, but Earth is, if you knew it was, then you could know if you were up or down. But you would only know it by the frame of reference. You would never know it based on you. That frame of reference tells you where you're at. The Lord is our frame of reference outside the earth. And that's where we figure out where we are, who we are, what's going on, what's up or down, and only by having the correct frame of reference. All right, we'll stop.